who's managing director and lead in the federal health equity space at Deloitte Consulting. And in a moment, as soon as we, oh, there we are, Crystal, welcome. We have Crystal Gary, who is Chief Advocacy Director at Ascension. And welcome to all three of you for joining us. We're going to start by having some presentations by our panelists, and then we're going to open it to our audience for question and answer. So again, welcome. And Crystal, if we could start with you, please, could you tell us a little bit about the activities of Ascension in the health equity space? Assuming you're on, and if not, we will, there you go, hi.
I am on, hello. And I have to apologize. For some reason, my computer just did not want to join the Zoom link, so I'm on my phone. And that means that I am not able to share the lovely slides that I had to share, but I'm happy to talk through our approach and what we're doing. So first, I just wanted to give a brief introduction to Ascension. I'm the Chief Advocacy Officer for Ascension Illinois. I oversee our government affairs and public policy, our diversity, inclusion, and health equity work, as well as patient experience. And Ascension is one of the largest Catholic healthcare organizations in the country, with over 150,000 associates, an additional 40,000 aligned providers, and we're focused on providing personalized, compassionate care. Our mission is to provide spiritually centered, holistic care to all persons with special attention to those who are poor and vulnerable. And we also believe in being advocates for a compassionate and just society. In Ascension, Illinois, I serve the Ascension's Illinois market. We have 10 acute care hospitals, 3 specialty hospitals, and a network of over 200 affiliated providers, employed providers, and care sites serving the Chicagoland area. Ascension has adopted the National Institutes of Health domains for health equity measurement to provide us with a framework to address the elements necessary to achieve health equity and eliminate disparities. So if you could have seen my beautiful slides, they would have been in front of you, but those 5 domains are culture of equity, structure of equity, equitable access to care, equitable quality care and patient safety, and collaborations and partnerships. So under culture of equity, that really includes recognizing and prioritizing the elimination of disparities, making sure that that is embedded in our strategic plan, creating environments where all individuals feel safe in addressing difficult topics, and advocating for public and private policies that advance equity. Under the structure of equity, that's really looking internally into the policies and procedures that promote health equity, data collection to monitor the outcomes of individuals with social risk factors, and then continuous learning systems to assess how we are doing. Equitable access to care is ensuring that all individuals, particularly those who are poor, vulnerable, and have social risk factors, are able to easily get affordable and convenient care to meet their needs. The equitable quality care and patient safety is ensuring that we are looking at our patient data and addressing any disparities in how our patients, in our patients' experience and or our patients' health outcomes. And then under collaborations and partnerships, really looking at how we are working with others and, elevating our voice and our influence to address the social determinants of health that are not amenable to what the health system alone can do. So that's the bigger picture, what Ascension is doing as a system. And then those health equity priorities cascade to the markets to for us to implement within our own operations and our own strategies. So when it comes to what we've been focused on specifically in Ascension, Illinois, under that culture of equity, Ascension has launched our diversity, equity, and inclusion framework is called ABIDE, which is appreciation, belongingness, inclusivity, diversity, and equity. So we've been really focused over the past year or so in our implementation of ABIDE across the Ascension Illinois organization. And that has really starts with listening. There have been listening sessions that have occurred, within our ministries across our associates. And then psychological safety. So speaking about the processes of having that psychological safety, we have created an abide engagement committee. So, you know, leaders and associates from across our market coming together and, you know, working on, you know, how do we make sure that all of our associates are understanding what we mean by abide, are experiencing more of an abide culture, and are experiencing and that we are growing into that culture of psychological safety. So that's including diversity and inclusion trainings on implicit bias, on cultural competency, and trainings on having a culture of psychological safety. And then we also have done an associate survey, which again is asking our associates for their input, their feedback, and how they are feeling and experiencing our culture and where they see that we might have opportunities to improve. Under the structure of equity, last year we did an organizational health equity assessment to really establish a baseline for us and give us information on how we are doing in being an equitable organization. And that really gave us some guidance as to where we might want to focus in making sure that we do have the policies and processes in place for equity and to support equity. And then also making sure that we have a structure in place for the social determinant of health screening for our patients and to refer them to the resources and the supports that they may need. And equitable access to care, that's a lot of where our advocacy work lives and advocating for state and federal policies that really advance that goal of equitable access to care. And a lot of our partnerships and collaborations have been with other organizations to elevate that advocacy voice. So being a part of the Healthcare Anchor Network and part of Healthcare Without Harm are two examples. Under equitable quality care and safety, we established a health equity dashboard where we're looking at a lot of those health outcome metrics that we typically have tracked, but making sure that we are tracking those by race, ethnicity, and language so that we have an awareness and can ensure that we're not seeing certain of our patient populations that may be having different experiences. And then in collaboration and partnership, there are a number of local and national collaborations, as I mentioned, from the advocacy side, but even on the health equity side that we are a part of. And so I just wanted to close thinking about what are some of the policy actions and priorities and some of the things that, we've experienced that government has done or could do that really supports and props up this work. And so this is more specific to Illinois and the Illinois market, but in access to care, and Medicaid expansion is, one of those big things. Illinois is an expansion state, has been for a long time. Illinois has also extended programs to cover the undocumented who may not be eligible for Medicaid, and also has specifically invested in behavioral health funding in order to extend access to care, to behavioral health care for those individuals that may need it. So we've been a big part of the advocacy community around promoting and advocating for and achieving those policy goals. In health equity, there are several things that our leaders in Illinois, the General Assembly and Governor Pritzker have done to really help create that statewide policy environment and culture for health equity. So a couple of years ago, they passed a racial equity and healthcare package. One of the things that is now required under that package is all hospitals in Illinois submit community benefit reports. We have to report those federally, but we also report those to the Illinois Attorney General. As a part of that state level reporting now, there are requirements specific to reporting of efforts around health equity and what we're doing and then what our results and outcomes have been around that. So that's just a level of support and transparency around health equity and also just a signal that there is really a desire and expectation that the healthcare healthcare community in Illinois is actively engaged in this. There is now a requirement for renewal of licensure for clinicians to have health equity training. And so that's something that's being put into effect starting in January. And then it's just been helpful from the federal perspective to see that, HHS, that CMS, Has been putting out requests for information and other signals that they are also looking more at health equity and, you know, putting more of a focus and priority on that. So it really helps to highlight the importance of this work that we are all doing on the ground. And then under community engagement and partnerships, another thing that Illinois is doing, you know, they've created the healthcare transformation initiative, and it's a fund that encourages partners, both healthcare hospital partners working with other community-based organizations to develop collaboratives that are specifically geared toward addressing health disparities in particular underserved communities. And so that's another thing, by providing that pot of funding and providing really an infrastructure to incentivize and to promote that work, we've seen a lot of efforts that have, that have launched over the last year. One of our hospitals, our footprint is on the west side of Chicago, and we've been engaged in that collaborative and some of those discussions. And what are things that we can do both within the provision of healthcare and extending out to some of those root causes of the social determinants of health in order to, really advance this work. And that's something that, though some things had already been put in place, really voluntarily from the healthcare community, but, you know, passing that program and including that funding was something that from a policy perspective was really impactful in accelerating that work.
Terrific.
So I will pause there.
Wonderful overview. Thank you so much. It's really exciting on the breadth of initiatives within Ascension and then the state, as you've described. Let's turn it to Melissa. Could you tell us a bit about the Build Challenge, please, and what you all have been doing?
Yeah, thank you for having me. My name is Melissa Monbouquette. I'm the Deputy Director of the Build Health Challenge. Let me just share my slides with you all. Great. Can everyone see this okay? All right, excellent. So the Build Health Challenge is a national initiative. Our mission is to create a new norm in the US that centers community-driven cross-sector partnerships at the heart of health for everyone, to improve health for everyone. And we're started in 2015 out of a response to the Affordable Care Act in an effort to ensure that as hospitals were thinking about their community benefit requirements, that they were thinking about looking at prevention and community work as they were investing that funding. BILD is an acronym. It stands for Bold, Upstream, Integrated, Local, and Data-Driven. These are partnerships that aspire toward a fundamental shift beyond short-term programmatic work to longer-term influences over policy, regulation, and systems-level changes. They are focused on the social, environmental, and economic factors that have the greatest influence on the health of the community, rather than access to or care delivery. They're aligning the practices and perspectives of multiple organizations and sectors under a shared vision, establishing new roles in that work, while also continuing to draw upon the strengths and assets of each partner. They're engaging neighborhood residents and community leaders as key voices and thought leaders throughout all stages of planning and implementation. I think that's a really important piece of this that you'll hear me return back to, this focus on lived experience is expertise. No one understands better what the ramifications of a policy might be than those who are going to experience it. Those who are impacted should be at the center of the conversation and the implementation of this work. And they use data from both clinical and community sources as a tool to identify key needs, measure meaningful change, and facilitate transparency among stakeholders to generate insights and action. So each BILD partnership is at its heart a community-based organization, a nonprofit working with residents. They also are partnered with local health departments and a hospital, health system, or health plan. Actually, really glad Cristal is here from Ascension. Ascension is one of the hospital partners in the Milwaukee partnership. So it's nice to hear about some of the other work that is happening at Ascension as well. And they're working upstream. So we leave it up to the communities to determine what issue they want to work on, but it's something, a condition that is affecting the health of the community. So some common issues are housing, transportation, education, food access and food justice, safety and violence prevention, social isolation, you name it, it's a pretty diverse range of issue areas. And that makes sense because when you look at the map of where build communities are, it's a pretty diverse group. They are in red states and blue states, urban and rural communities. We have funded 55 partnerships to date. And we actually have an open call for applications that closes on Thursday for 19 more to join the program, which we're very excited about. I'd be remiss if I did not acknowledge, oh, I'm missing some of their graphics, our amazing funding collaborative that's made this possible. This is both the group that has supported the third cohort and our upcoming fourth cohort. They've just been really wonderful in terms of providing resources, innovation, and their wisdom to support this process. And so I think the next question is usually, does it work? Do these collaboratives achieve what they hope to achieve? And I think the answer is yes. We have a pretty robust evaluation process in place. In addition to the funding we provide communities, we also provide technical assistance, national communication support, evaluation support, network building, and we actually require the hospitals or health plans to match our funding in the hopes of it being a sustainable contribution. And while we were doing the evaluation for the last cohort, which wrapped in 2019, we found that they had achieved 58 systems level changes. That includes new and reallocated funding streams, shifts in scaling of organizational practices and policies, but also legislative and regulatory policy change. Build communities usually are working at the local level, so city, county, municipal, sometimes state, which you'll hear one example of shortly. But we know that this work happening in 2 years is pretty impressive because working on upstream issues and social determinants of health is often generational in scale and in terms of seeing outcomes. So my first example here is the New Brunswick, New Jersey team. They are, they've been with Build since 2017, and they are developing and driving policy changes to ensure healthier homes. You can see the list of partners here. They also work with Rutgers quite a bit. And initially when they started out with Build, they were really focused on developing their community health ambassador program and providing case management to their neighborhood, which is predominantly Latino. They wanted to make sure that they were training residents from the neighborhood to serve in these roles, to build trust among residents and the agencies that serve them. And make sure that they were collecting and using data in a way that the community residents were comfortable with. They also wanted to, they developed a medical legal partnership so that when there's health harming housing conditions, that residents had resources to turn to address those when needed with legal services. Over the last 2 years, they've shifted to really focus on policy and making policy changes that will make these changes sustained. Through their work with Rutgers, as well as with our technical assistance team at Change Lab Solutions, they did some robust policy analysis looking at what health supporting housing policies are available in New Brunswick and in New Jersey, and what could they pursue. And then they worked with the community members through the community health ambassadors to prioritize a few policies and also get those residents trained on how to pursue policy and policy change and advocacy. So they've had a number of wins, which is amazing. They've been working with the mayor of New Brunswick has been really supportive of this work. They have new and improved rental registration policies. They have passed a rent late fee cap, requiring rent receipts, other things that support this community, which is often a very vulnerable one in terms of being taken advantage of. And so they also, just recently, I love this version because you can see over here on the left, one of the community health ambassadors testifying at city council. And they were able to pass a new ordinance based on the community health ambassador's testimony that will support them in terms of making sure that they're not taken advantage of in terms of utilities and that they have access to utilities and don't have any price gouging. And so after this meeting, when the city council members at the end of the recording, you can hear her commending the community members for participating, that this is what civic engagement should look like, and this is what how democracy should work in terms of residents showing up, testifying, providing their experience, and asking for this change, and city council stepping up to provide it. In New Orleans, they've taken a different tack. They are focused on promoting better birth outcomes for Black women specifically by creating supportive environments and establishing community clinical linkages for breastfeeding families. This team is focused on the Columbia Park area, which was a large government housing project that was destroyed during Katrina. And as it's been redeveloped, they've pursued a number of different types of programs and resources for this community to rebuild and thrive. And so one of their focus here, they also work with Educare New Orleans and the Breastfeeding Center at the Tulane School of Public Health. And they want to make sure, first of all, that new parents are supported. That includes perinatal home visits, virtual and in-person lactation consultations, an emergency hotline for parents, and resource distribution. It's not a secret to anyone. New Orleans is often a target of hurricanes, increasing as climate change continues, and making sure that parents can continue to provide safe and healthy food access to their babies has been a really critical piece. And you'll see on the next page, on the next slide, a picture of one of their care kits, which includes things like flashlights, pumps, batteries, sanitizing products, and other things you might need to make sure that you have a safe and healthy food supply. And they provide that in a bucket, which is something they heard from the community members was really important as well. And so that was really important last year when they were hit by a hurricane and were out without power for several days. They've also provided workshops and education to over 1,000 perinatal professionals and caregivers through these trainings. And then they've pursued the Mama Plus policy agenda, which is loosely based on the Momnibus legislation that was being advanced at the federal level, but this is focused in the state of Louisiana. And they have had some pretty incredible successes when you think about Louisiana's, is, I think, generally known as a more conservative state in terms of their health policies. The new maternal mental health bill goes into effect August 1, which is fantastic. Victoria Williams, who's just this fantastic advocate and is part of this team in New Orleans, has been sitting on the task force developing this, these standards and the implementation plan for this. In light of the formula shortage, they also passed a new legislation requiring that human donor milk is eligible for reimbursement, for insurance reimbursement. Last year, they passed a legislation that requires health insurance to cover midwives and set up a state registry and standard for doulas. That's important because it's the first step in getting insurance coverage for that work as well, which has been a lifeline for many Black mothers. And then just as a note, that policy is complicated and not always, not everything is roses for sure, as we all know, I think, this week. That they were trying to expand Medicaid coverage from birth, and currently it goes until 60 days after birth to 12 months. It unanimously passed the Senate and then was rejected in the Finance Committee during the budgeting stage, which is unfortunate, but shows that there is a lot of support for this kind of work to take place. And I think I am going to pause actually on this, but I can touch back on it later, looking at some of the trends in the future. I think for us, we're really thinking about building our network of national change makers across the country on this community level work and how we can support them across that work while continuing to center residents as the key voices in advancing this policy change. If you're interested in learning more about Build. We have a lot of resources on our website, including the report that you just saw flash by your screen at buildhealthchallenge.com/resources. And I will turn it over to my fellow presenters.
Terrific. And we will get back to some of the recent trends and evidence that you all have been building off of. But in the meantime, let's turn over to Jessica, please. Jessica, tell us what's going on at Deloitte and in its numerous health equity initiatives.
Sure. So Jessica Nadler, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm a managing director at Deloitte. I wear multiple hats at Deloitte. We are the world's largest life sciences and healthcare consulting firm. So again, multiple hats. The two that are most relevant today are I am the health equity lead for our federal health practice. So I will talk a bit at the end around some of the projects I do with my clients here in DC in the Beltway. But I also want to talk a bit about what we Deloitte do as an organization. And so in my role as an advisor to our new Deloitte Health Equity Institute, we actually have been thinking really deeply about what it looks like for us as an organization, a large employer, to really think about health equity writ large, not just for our clients, but also for ourselves. So I kind of wanted to start with the definition of health equity. The definition that we at Deloitte are using is the fair and just opportunity for everyone to fulfill their human potential in all aspects of health and well-being. And I think the words are important because it sets the stage for really the breadth of what we're talking about. And both Cristal and Melissa have talked about really nice examples that are expanding that aperture. We're really not talking just about access to healthcare. We're talking about all of the drivers of health. We're talking about everybody as a whole human and their health and well-being, not just whether they can see a physician or not. So we also have made a strong statement publicly that health is a human right and that health equity is a moral imperative. But we realize that a moral imperative is something that requires business solutions in order to make the really systemic changes that we're talking about. And so I wanted to set the stage also with some business facts around the health inequities we see in our country. So currently, disparities cost the US $93 billion in excess medical costs and $42 billion in lost productivity per year. So those are with a B. Sometimes you can't hear B versus M, that's a B, for our nation every year. It's estimated that the US economic output would increase by $2.7 trillion annually if race-based disparities, both within the healthcare system and beyond, were addressed. $2.7 trillion. So we are talking about large economic impacts on our nation due to the disparities and inequities that exist in our systems. We also know that a lot of people are putting off care because they don't have the insurance. So we know that 51% of adults delay care and 29% put off getting prescriptions refilled because they don't have insurance. And then finally, we know that that percentage goes up a lot when we talk about our Black and Latinx communities. So for example, 2x of Black adults are delaying care without insurance and 1.5x of Latinx. So I just want to put those numbers out there because those are really big numbers about what this impact is in our nation. But it's also important to talk about what those root causes are that we are all talking about how we are addressing through our different mechanisms of action in our different organizations. So first, I think it's important to call out racism and bias inside and outside the healthcare system. So the inequities that we see are pervasive, and they are pervasive across a lot of different sections of identity. So not just race, but gender, age, income. But the differences we see in race and ethnicity are particularly troubling because the differences in health outcomes have to do with racism, not having to do with race. So I want to pause to sort of say that in a different way, that race is very much a social construct, not a biological construct. And so when we think about health outcomes and health care, it's important that we take that step back and understand that racism is the cause of the disparity, not race. The next piece that I think was covered really nicely by both Cristal and Melissa was the fact that there are these deep inequities in the non-medical drivers of health. We're talking about housing, we're talking about education, we're talking about clean water, we're talking about financial well-being. All of those pieces have deep inequities in our nation, and those have outcomes in health. And then finally, there's the structural flaws in our health system, and that's where we start talking about people's access, both geographically and from a cost perspective, and thinking about what it looks like to have a more equitable health system. So I wanted to put those three pieces out there because I think we've all thought about them, but it's important to kind of call them out very specifically. When we at Deloitte think about how our own organization, but also our clients' organizations can impact those systems, we break it down into sort of four domains of action. So the first one is the organization itself. And when I think about that, it is very much getting your own house in order as an organization. So what does your workforce look like? Does your workforce have safe housing? Do they have a clean environment? So we at Deloitte actually have done a lot of work over the last several years putting out what we have called our transparency report, which talks about the self-reported race and ethnicity of all of our staff in the US firm, Where we stand in terms of people advancing their careers at our organization, what does our diversity look like at leadership? Are we able to retain our diverse staff? All of those pieces that are key to essentially us being an organization that really lives our DEI. And so that is something that we counsel our clients on. You have to get your house in order. And to get your house in order is the only way you can start thinking about step two, which is what are the offerings you have as your core business. So for us at Deloitte, it's consulting. And I'll talk a bit more about the type of consulting work that I do with the federal government, but really thinking about how we can bring equity into the work we do with our clients. So that's the second mechanism. So for a healthcare organization, it's the care you provide. For a large pharmaceutical company, it's the drugs that you bring to market. All of those pieces are things that need to be really deeply and intentionally thought about to understand whether you are bringing about equity or you are reinforcing the inequity. The third domain of action we think about is community. And I think we've also talked a bit about that today, but really outside of your kind of core business, what impact do you have on the community where you reside? So I'm sitting here, I'm actually currently in McLean, Virginia. I am a DC resident. But we at Deloitte are very much thinking about what is the ecosystem of health equity within DC and the greater DMV, and where do we play outside of the fact that we're a large employer? What might we do with our community? What organizations do we network with? Where do we send all of our practitioners when we go to Impact Day in June, and we send all of our staff out to do community service projects? All of those pieces are the impact that we can have on equity writ large, but also health equity within our community. And then the fourth and sort of broader piece of this is the ecosystem piece. So for example, one of the ways we think about this at Deloitte is, what's our impact on the environment? Like, we're a consulting firm. In fact, we're a large global consulting firm. Pre-pandemic, we were sending people in planes all over the world. What did that mean for the air quality for us here in DC? I'm not far from Dulles, where I sit right now, but what was that impact that we had? How else do we think about where do we buy products and services for us as an organization? Are we helping and buying from small, local, diversely owned businesses, or are we, again, pushing the sort of status quo by not really thinking about that footprint we have in our ecosystem? So those were the four domains of action we think about. One of the ecosystem pieces that we have focused on over the last couple of years is our Health Equity Institute. And so that was founded in 2021. As you might expect, there was a lot going on nationally in 2021. We were well into COVID at that point and really understanding the deep inequities in the burden of COVID on different communities across our nation. We had, as a nation, experienced the murder of George Floyd and what that did to each of us in our own selves and homes and in our communities and how we thought about that. And so all of this was inspiration for us as Deloitte to put our stake out there and say, like, we need to have this Health Equity Institute. We want to, instead of just doing our core services of consulting, we want to have an external think tank that puts some of those products and analytics and a lot of things out into the world in a way where everyone can access them, as opposed to just having them be a core service of Deloitte. So one of the things we thought about with the Health Equity Institute is, how do we as an organization drive exponential change in health equity across multiple industries? We have that breadth as an organization. We don't just serve healthcare organizations. We serve telecommunications organizations. We serve educational organizations. I sit with the federal government. And so we have a breadth that not everyone has. So how do we think across all of those organizations to really think about the systemic pieces that we want to make a change in? And so when we thought about what Deloitte looks like, what our reach is, and what we might be able to use as levers in the world, there were sort of three primary action levers that we use. The first one being, how do we activate key decision makers? And when I say key decision makers, I'm talking about people who sit on corporate boards and people who are in the C-suite of large organizations across the entire country, not just healthcare organizations. We're talking about anything, Verizon, we're talking about Cargill, anybody, Ford, doesn't matter. How do you get more diverse voices on those boards and in those leadership rooms? And how do you equip them to ask the difficult questions and raise the difficult topics that will bring about really deep conversation and action on what needs to happen around equity? The next piece is advancing equitable communities through place-based change. I won't go into that because I think, Melissa, you did a wonderful job of talking about individual local organizations and the ecosystems that they've built, but that's exactly what we're thinking about when we think about place-based change. And then the final piece is health equity, innovation, and learning across the country. And so that's where we're thinking about broad partnerships that we have. How can we spur innovation around health equity? So for example, we have a partnership with New Profit. And so they are a group that incubates startup companies. And so they have their first health equity catalyzed cohort. So we are incubating 8 early stage equity nonprofits to essentially see where our investment can help ideas flourish and grow. And then another piece of that is we have put data out there. We partnered with the March of Dimes to look at essentially maternity care deserts and put maps from a county level across the entire country that allows everybody to look at where the maternity care deserts are across our nation. So that is data that when people who are making decisions, they can sit and look at it and understand what it really looks like. So I'm gonna do a quick pivot. I know that I only have a couple minutes left. That's the larger Deloitte ecosystem. I'll talk a little bit about where I sit in federal health. I serve mostly different parts of the Department of Health and Human Services, but I have colleagues who sit at the VA. I have colleagues who work with the military health system. I have colleagues who work with large states and also with higher educational institutions, all of which have a piece around health. I had the honor last summer to lead a team in the support of the White House COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. This is, it was a federal advisory committee. So it in fact fell under all of the Federal Advisory Committee Act rules. So a very structured group of people who were called on across the country to advise the White House on what was happening in COVID-19 at the time. So they got stood up in January of 2021 on an executive order that President Biden put in place on Inauguration Day. And they were essentially doing monthly sprints February, March, you can count out all through last January through the spring, monthly sprints on how COVID was impacting communities around things like behavioral health, things like vaccine access, things like actual structural racism and what does that look like. And every month they were generating a set of recommendations that they talked about in public meetings that went to the White House. We at the end had to synthesized, they had 320 some plus individual recommendations that they generated over the course of their 6 months worth of work. We prioritized those and kind of structured them into a report that went to the White House last October. That's all public. You can see the report itself. You can see all of the 320 recommendations as well as the implementation plan. But those were, fast and furious. I don't think anybody had ever seen a federal advisory committee move that fast. Those recommendations went to the White House, and we are starting to see essentially pieces of them filter through the different parts of the federal government. The one piece that I think is worth calling out is particularly because the federal government in many ways is several degrees of freedom away from the delivery of care or housing or education for an individual human. One of the things that is most important, I think, at the federal government is the data that they use when they make decisions around policy. And what is apparent and became increasingly apparent through the course of COVID was that the data that the federal government has essentially makes many people invisible because there isn't sufficient data or really good characterization of some of the race and ethnicity. It either isn't structured well, and so they don't know. For example, the worst offender of this is the checkbox on Asian American. what does that even mean? And the outcomes of people who might check that box are vastly different, such that when you average them, you really have no idea what's happening with those populations. But worse even, that a lot of the data that the federal government has missing data. And the structures and systems which the federal government uses to gather that data don't really work well to get better data. And so a lot of the recommendations that were strongly made to the White House were to make that investment in the data infrastructure that the federal government uses so that people are actually visible and that you can actually understand what is happening to a Black trans woman in DC when it pertains to COVID, because right now the federal government really has no idea. And so I'll pause there. We touch a lot of different federal organizations thinking about how they plan for and implement policy. The task force was just one example, but the outcomes of that task force and the set of prioritized recommendations are a really thoughtful and thought-provoking set of recommendations to think about policy and implementation writ large.
Terrific. Thank you so much for that overview, Jessica. I appreciate it. I wonder, Crystal, if we could turn back to you. You also talked a fair bit about getting the Ascension House in order and a lot of thoughtful initiatives around the culture and management policies that you have in within your organization. And then you turned also to data collection and metrics. Where do you see some policies that might be needed around metrics? What metrics are you missing where you'd like more research or more background or more data collection or assistance with data collection or data collection by your collaborators? So are there some gaps in there that you're seeing that are keeping you from moving forward in your work?
Oh, wow. What a huge question. the answer is yes. And the challenge is twofold. I mean, first, we are in the process right now of, identifying where there are those gaps. And then the second part is, how do you use that information? How do you make it usable and actionable? And how do you, make sure that you're, that you have helpful information and not just overwhelmed by it? So it really kind of goes in those two different areas. And I would say that we're still very much at the beginning of that journey. So when it comes to, so Ascension, and I mean not just Ascension Illinois, but nationally, is really in the process now and developing some partnerships around, how do we capture information about our patients in the geographies that we serve? So how do we, really look at community level data, community level, social determinants of health that may be impacting the patients that we serve, and be able to pull that together into some profiles that can help inform how we better serve those individuals. So that's one piece of it. I can't speak to the specifics of, kind of exactly what information, all of that looks like, but doing that gap analysis right now will help, help us identify what would be more useful for us to have, what additional information do we want to try to focus on, and working collaboratively and figuring out how we might be able to fill those out.
That makes a lot of sense. It sounds like what I'm hearing is that while this can be very much a local grassroots from the bottom kind of effort, there are components of this where reinventing the wheel across each community doesn't make a lot of sense. And maybe data, metrics, needs assessment, the kinds of things you're craving across your communities, there's some efficiencies to be gained there and ways to then tailor them. But continue, you had another thought on this.
That's a good summary. And so, I probably should have mentioned that last year, Ascension created a position, a chief community impact officer position, and a department that's really looking at how do we impact our community, how do we engage in that type of work around, and is taking the lead on what our response is as a system in those five domains that I shared, and that that piece of both how are we capturing the social determinant of health data for our patient population, how are we doing those screenings and standardizing how we do that, and then how we make those referrals externally, and from a policy perspective, as you asked, you know, what does that look like as far as incorporating that into our, you know, patient medical record, electronic medical record, and, you know, making that more available to the clinicians that are serving those individuals is also a piece of it. So there is that individual piece, but then we think that there is very much this bigger picture community, you know, piece and some efficiencies that could be, you know, leveraged, leveraged in that way. And then on the other side, well, the other piece of what I was going to say is, in addition to looking at those, social determinants of health and kind of root cause factors, there's also the what happens, in the care experience and the delivery of care itself. And I did mention that we have that, health equity dashboard that we have developed to start looking at what that, what that looks like across our ministries, and are there any areas where we do see that outcomes, might be different based on race, ethnicity, or language. What we're learning or what we're looking at now is, do we have the right metrics? Are we looking at the right things? What is the literature telling us, and what's the national data telling us about where we should be focusing, where we should be targeting and looking at that data? So we've partnered with our chief clinical officer, our chief medical officer, to really, kind of think about and discern what that should look like and what the next iteration of that dashboard might look like, because maybe it's not, I'm just going to make something up, but, maybe it's not necessarily looking at overall readmission rates, and maybe it's looking at something drilled down a little bit more specific, around, OB or oncology. So those are just some of the ways that we're approaching that now.
Excellent. And Melissa, in your communities, sort of what evidence base are you reaching back to? Do you have gaps in the evidence base? It sounds like I'm hearing sort of home visiting, things that are well known to be effective approaches, for example, for pregnant women. So are there gaps there where your communities have identified a priority and yet isn't really sure what their next step might be?
Yeah. So I think one thing that is somewhat unique about Build, but compared to other sort of funding programs that may be out there or more government style programs, is that Build is focused on long-term systems change. So policy, systems, social and environmental. And so thinking about how we make those changes. And what we've really learned is that it's a both and approach. You can't select, I'm going to work long-term only while the folks in my community are struggling or are facing barriers to health access, to resources that they need, have critical needs for. And in COVID, that was really demonstrated how inequitable that access was and the barriers. But the long-term work is really challenging, and it's hard to think long-term in terms of funding. Most funding is only for a few years at a time, not for 10, 20, 30 years, which is really often what this work change requires to make change. It is often not meant, is very rarely available for collaborative work, for community brainstorming sessions, to pay residents to participate in these conversations, provide childcare, provide food, make sure that they have time to participate in these sessions. And so I think that is really a challenge for Build communities to understand, like, what does progress look like in the 2 to 3 years that they're with Build, which is really only a blip on their longer trajectory of health change. And so we have worked a lot with our evaluation team to understand what indicators of change might be before they're actually happening, those shifts in mindset, the relationships that are built, establishing trust and addressing power dynamics. Those pieces we believe, but we haven't been doing this long enough to see play out, are indicators that health outcomes will also shift ultimately. But I think that is really a gap in research that is out there, because that work is not as common to be thinking that the long-term strategy work, so.
One of the questions we have here is an interesting one. It's from an individual in the county that has started, it sounds like they've started an equity and community investment initiative or a racial equity task force. and wants to know sort of where to get started around realistic goals. And what I'm hearing from, I believe, all three of you is that these goals in part are coming from the impacted communities. So what is a priority goal is at the community level, something that is considered a priority goal, not necessarily something that's a goal from another community. But this is a legitimate question. You're in a community and you're starting an initiative. Where do you begin? Jessica, do you have some resources that you might point someone? We can't go through them all of them here, but what might be an approach to tackling the where do I begin?
It's an interesting question. And so because I sit at the federal level, I think a lot about the idea that federal funding and policy tends to trickle down like Plinko from the federal government out to the actual communities that need it. And one of the disadvantages of that is that there are a lot of communities doing wonderful things, but there hasn't been a lot of spread of best practices, I think. I think there has been difficulty in kind of seeing what works in one community and tailoring it for the next. But I also think that it just, there hasn't been investment in doing that. And so I think there are organizations, I think like Melissa's, that are doing wonderful work that are probably a better place to start than some state or governmental entities. I think that there are associations that are doing interesting work. There's the Association of, I'm going to get this wrong, it's ASTO, Association of State Territorial
Health Organizations. Yes, we're affiliated with them, and George Mason.
And like NACHO, which is city and county. Sure. I think that there are associations of people who are seeing broadly and get together and have a chance to talk about it. But in terms of like that go-to resource, I think in many ways that's missing. I would love to hear from Melissa and Crystal whether they've got go-tos, but I think that that's a hard piece, and it's one of the things that we struggle at the federal level, and I wonder whether we should be funding it better at the federal level.
So I should put in a plug. I am the vice chair of the Community Preventative Services Task Force, which looks at evidence for community-based approaches to improve health. And so I would refer folks to the community guide for the systematic reviews of the evidence of what works. That's not to say that that's the approach to determining your priorities. How does Ascension do that? How do you disseminate information on what's working within your large organization?
So I, before I answer that question, let me go back and give a little bit more of a response. You know, I started at the beginning to say that, you know, when we launched this work, we started with listening. And I just don't think that there is a substitute for that. Yes, it takes time. Yes, sometimes people want to just go straight to solutioning, straight to setting a goal. But I think the first goal should really be to listen. The first goal should really be to engage. You know, especially I have a background working in government. So before I switched to the private sector, so especially when you're, you know, when you're in government, you know, making sure that you are, you know, building out the opportunities and the, you know, infrastructure to hear directly from the community. The community health needs assessment can be, you know, one starting place for identifying what some of those needs and priorities are, but, you know, listening. I mentioned the collaboratives that we are a part of. One of those collaboratives here in Chicago is the is Westside United. And that's not a government organization. It was an organization that was, you know, founded by us and several health systems that serve the west side of Chicago. Rush University Medical Center was really took the lead in that. You know, but that is an organization that, you know, has really taken a life of its own, but it was, you know, it was created as a way for us to, you know, to really have a platform and an infrastructure to engage the community directly and to work collaboratively with people, you know, the people who live in those communities and the nonprofit organizations that directly serve those communities in order to help develop what those priorities need to be.
Terrific. And of course, sitting here in an academic institution, we have a question. I like this next one, which is how can faculty, and I'll extend that to curriculum, help you and your organizations to achieve your goals and the work that you're doing in health equity? So what's missing there in terms of either partnerships or training?
I can jump in on something I would love to see. So As someone who went back and did a master's degree later in life, and as someone who works in the space that I do, I would love to see more training around social determinants of health and community indicators and how to do that work versus, not to downplay the importance of epidemiology and statistics and all of the other pieces that are critical pieces of public health training, but understanding how much your community plays a role in your health and how public health practitioners can really step into that space is something I would love to see happening more regularly across the public health academia spectrum.
Excellent. Any thoughts on that, Crystal or Melissa?
I would just say, and I think some of this is already starting to happen, but, you know, as we've been doing a lot of work internally, you know, we also have several teaching hospitals and in our GME programs, we've been doing a lot of work and training on health disparities, you know, and on implicit bias. And, you know, I just think that there's a lot of work to be done to, you know, really socialize that, to educate about that, to create safe spaces to discuss the impact, as Jessica said, that, you know, that racial health disparities are the result of racism. And, you know, so the more that we can start to build those, you know, incorporate that into curriculum and, you know, and build spaces to have those conversations and to, you know, really be graduating leaders who are informed and prepared to engage in that type of work, and, you know, everywhere, because this work should not just be, you know, owned by one particular person within an organization, but it really has to be something that is owned collectively.
And if I heard correctly, that's some of the starting ground for Deloitte and its work with some of its clients as well, is to set that educational foundation. In the last minute, what I want to do most is thank all three of you for a really terrific panel. Thank you so much today for joining us today and talking about health equity. And to our audience, thank you for participating. We had really terrific attendance today. And we have our next session in 2 weeks on workforce and where we go next in the policy space there. So thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.